They were here with the Shabbat Shore, former number 11 in the world, and played with many great players, such as Amir Shabana, Nick Matthew, Gregory Gaultier, David Palmer during his time. Hisham, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much, my pleasure. Pleasure's all mine.
You grew up in Cairo. What was playing squash like there?
Actually, I was so lucky that since day one, squash was very big and started in the, it's been there since the 50s and the 60s, were very strong, but in the 90s when it started with Ahmed Barada, we took the game to the next level, and kids and parents and everybody started like getting really, they devoted themselves for this game, and this is what created amazing competition. And that's why I think we're very lucky, because the competition is very, very strong, which created who we are today.
How is the squash culture in Egypt different than the squash culture you see in the United States?
I would say the only difference is back home, a mom would take her kid to the coach and tell him, just kill him, I don't care. She'd be like, just take him and kill him, I just want a champion. Do whatever it takes, just bring me a champion. And they have a little bit more time as well over there. Mom can send the kid to the club, and the kid would be, do his private, do his one-on-one, and then stay in the club, play matches with adults, with other kids and stuff, so they can spend more time in squash, you know. Here they're very limited to squash, the school is really hard too, so they don't get a lot of time here, so this is always our problem. We need more time,
right?
You know, so things can happen, you know?
How is the training style in Egypt different than that of the United States?
So the difference is, in actually in squash, in Egypt, we play attacking squash, so we're all attackers. Attackers, right. is we are always looking for volleys. We always try to take the ball too early. Even the technique when we teach kids when we're very young, when we were taught, it's all about, first of all, the grip, the way you hold the grip, and it's all about the swing and going over the ball, learning how to go over the ball. Going over the ball actually allows you to kill the ball, like hit low to the nick, or hit a low straight drive or cross court, and it's all about, it's going to be, we're hitting one, two, three tight shots. As soon as the ball leaves the wall, you have to attack it. Attack it doesn't mean you have to hit it that low or take the risk, but attack it. Do something with it. Push your opponent, move him around. It's not about up and down the wall. So this is the mentality, and this is how we think since we're really young, when we're very young, and that's the, this is how we work, you know? This is how we learn the game.
So you're taught from a young age to be looking to take the ball in as quick as you can, and looking to kind of end the rally when you can, when you have an opening.
It's always the challenge between, am I going to be too risky, or am I just attacking? Making sure I still have a higher margin, you know, but I'm just pushing my opponent to this corner and to this corner. It doesn't have to be that low, you know. It's not like, oh, as soon as the ball comes out, I have to finish it.
Right.
Of course, it depends on your racket skill.
Right.
Some people can do it. Mm-hmm. Some people can take it earlier than others. Some people can finish it earlier. It depends on the racket skill, but this is the way we go, you know.
And you're trying to impart that in the United States, correct, at your academy here?
So now kids, you know, it's new still for them to be always like attacking and raising your shoulders down, up and stuff like this, because most kids, you know, when you especially when you're young, you don't have this muscle yet, so you don't go over the ball, you're always like pushing down, elbows down. And we have a lot of kids also come from tennis, so we have this huge problem, which is elbows, and, you know, they go down, elbow down, so then you want to spin, so you have to fix the grip, fix the swing and stuff like this, but this is the direction we're always headed towards, you know.
You went pro when you were 18 years old and played on the tour for 14 years. Could you describe what it was like to be on the tour circuit?
And honestly, it's the best experience of my life. Like, this is one thing I would never, like, you know, time goes back. This is the only thing I would have loved to do, which is being a part of this professional tour, meeting these amazing squash players and having the pleasure and the honor to compete against some amazing, amazing professionals and meeting some very, very cool people all over the world. And, you know, it's very stressful, of course, because you have to win. It's your job, it's your money. But in the same time, we balanced it out between also meeting people and having a little bit of fun with the 5-6 hour training every day, and the jet lags and the flights, and making money sometimes, and sometimes making good money, sometimes not making money at all. So it was very stressful, but I think it was the best experience in my life.
What was your favorite tournament when you were playing?
I used to love, of course, I love the Tournament of Champions. A very prestigious event and a beautiful event.
Right here in New York.
Yes, New York. Beautiful. New York is where my heart is, by the way. I've been here for 5 years, and this is the best place in the world, and I love this place too much, way too much. And So I used to love Hong Kong, also the KFA Pacific Open, and New York. I loved, there wasn't a lot of tournaments, but I loved playing in Greece. Oh. That's where I beat my brother. I wasn't in seven. I love Greece. I love playing Greece. You know, Russia, Greece is very cool. And I honestly loved a lot of places. I just, you know, wherever we went, we were very welcomed. We were treated, we had the best treatment, and we were just, as the ATP in tennis,
yeah.
We have the PSA. We're not as big as them, but we have, as you know, we have our own huge, big world. We have our PSA Squash TV. We have live matches.
Do you see the squash game growing?
I think it's growing, actually, especially in America now. In America, people are starting to understand more about the game and about what's going on and about coaching and what's good and what's bad. Before, like 7 years ago, they were like, you know, squash, what is squash? You know, they go like, squash, right. What is squash? You know what squash is. Now people know that it is, it's one of the fastest sports in the world. It's fastest calorie burn sport in the world. And, you know, when matches go an hour, 15, right. Hour, 20, hour, 30. It's very hard.
Huh? I go places, sometimes they say, oh, they don't know what squash is, but they know racquetball.
I know, like, I don't like that. When I hear this part, I'm like, what?
What? You don't know what squash is.
And then I explain it's smaller racket, more strategic, more technical.
Right.
It's chess, as I have written here on my shirt. It's art plus chess at 150 miles per hour is squash. You know?
Right.
So it is, you understand at some point, you know, when you're moving your opponent from this corner to this corner and you're taking a couple of steps ahead and you know, you're moving it from this corner so you can actually, after this one, move him there and he's trying to do the same thing and who's gonna win and you have to be very athletic doing that. So it's chess at 150 miles per hour.
For tournaments, did you have a pre-match routine you would do?
For a match, what was very, very important was the warm-up.
Mm-hmm.
The warm-up is huge.
Right.
Sometimes between 20 and 30 minutes just to get your body and your mind. You know, some people listen to some certain music they like. Some people have to be on the bike. Some people have to run a treadmill. Some people have to sit and meditate.
Right.
Do a little bit of breathing and stuff like that. So it depends, actually. Everybody has his own rituals.
Just to get your mind in it.
Yep.
And then did that help you combat nerves when you were playing? Did you really face a lot of nerves when you were playing?
It's always like this, the first 4 or 5 points in a match, you're always testing the waters, you don't know what's going to happen, but a professional player is supposed to overcome this very quickly and start acting what's going to happen in the match, you know, and start like forgetting about this stressful first 3-4 minutes,
right.
Get out of it quickly and face reality and deal with what's going on, you know, because otherwise, if you don't forget about this quickly and get into it, the other guy's going to get into it and then you're going to be behind.